بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمد ونصلي على رسول الكريم أما بعد لا تقوم الساعة حتى يؤتمن الخائن ويخون الأمين قيامت will not occur until the treacherous will be regarded as trustworthy and the trustworthy honest upright will be regarded as unreliable treacherous dishonest. So Nabi alayhi salam has warned us of all these occurrences. We need to be vigilant and make sure that we ourselves are not a sign of Qiyamah. A believer is trustworthy, but does he display signs of treachery and dishonesty? And a disbeliever who doesn't have Iman is supposed to be unreliable and treacherous, but many of them are honest, upright. And people prefer to deal with them because of the akhlaq and the habits of the people of Iman. So we have to be very particular. Likewise, in a global scale, whatever plotting and planning is happening, even though it is outlined and it is knowledge, public knowledge, ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس. Whenever we point fingers, the people of Iman point fingers at themselves. This condition that is happening, although man is in front of it, there's a greater being, greater controller. So number one, I am the cause of all that is happening. And secondly is, if I want a solution for any problem, any issue, then the solution lies in turning to Allah, getting close to Allah, because He is the one who is in control. And that's why A'mal have been highlighted, so that one can realize and focus on the energies which is a solution and not the problem. Speaking about the problem does not solve anything, but looking for solutions. Many people stress about the problems, but they don't stress and worry about the solutions. So as discussed previously, on a global scale, on the virus side, effort has been made, a cover-up has been engineered. Through this, a sudden destruction of global economies and tens of millions of people have been impoverized. Industries, unemployment, homelessness, misery, and the projected starvation and the projected disruption of human lives would be more detriment than even the virus itself. So researchers have highlighted issues of the virus being small compared to the repercussions. Secondly, they've said that the increase of violence against children and women globally has increased to a phenomenal level where during the lockdown, the entire family was in one household. And the olden day structure where the mindset was وَلِيَسَعْكَ بَيْتُكَ, that your house should be comfortable, you should feel at home, that has lost mankind. Then number three, in people's house, certain laws have been introduced which psychologically has disrupted the perception of people. Simple things like a person going to the masjid, that psychological effect has been lost, where the sha'air of Allah, the signs of Allah have been displaced completely. Likewise, the concept of making salam, the concept of getting close to each other, ijtimas, bayanat, all those avenues where a person get close to Allah, psychologically has been erased and eroded. The fact that people who have been exposed to deen for so many years psychologically distance themselves from the people of deen and have justified even, although masla-wise, ulama have explained the masla of Jummah of a minimum amount and it could be read in the places, homes and your workplaces. Now people in the long term, what will be the ramification? Only Allah knows. So on the Dini side, although avenues of evil has closed, but when a person does not abstain from sin voluntarily, and it is through coercion and through rules and regulations, then he is like a bird in a cage waiting to get out. A fish out of water waiting for the water. So a person will play catch up on all these forms of ma'asiyat and disobedience. But besides that, all good actions and deeds that were in his life disappears and dissipates. If we look at it, even on a social media level, most people have become muftis and ulama and great mashaykh overnight. People posting their own videos, posting masail, posting advices, which if it's done on the confines of Shariat, with the regulations of Shariat, based on the conditions for a person to do that, that's a separate topic on its own. But the ramification of a person considering themselves to be knowledgeable, and we will come to those alamat of Qiyamah and signs, where the ignorant will consider themselves to be knowledgeable. So the psychological effects, 600 doctors and a lot of petitions and scientists have come together, Nobel Prize winners, just to make sure to inform the president that they want to end the lockdown. Then number four, the diagnostic test for COVID-19, which is scientifically meaningless, useless, completely void, and we will get into that inshallah. Then the vaccines that have been prepared and the harms that has been extensively documented and the lethality of this, that's another aspect on its own. An expert in vaccines, Dr. Stefan Lanka, has written, only ignorant people who blindly trust in state authorities who are testing and approving the vaccines can regard vaccination as a small, harmless prick. The verifiable facts demonstrate the danger and negligence of these scientists and politicians who claim that vaccines are safe, have little or no side effects, and would protect from a disease. None of these claims are true or even scientific. A lot of books have been written and details, if you want to study, we can go into that. Then number six, the expansion of surveillance to be introduced. And if we look at one of them, it's called contact tracing. Despite the fact that even the World Health Organization study on influenza, on pandemics in 2019, this is their conclusion, not mine's, contact tracing is not useful from an epidemiological point of view. It is not useful at all. And their words are, it is not recommended for any circumstances. It is not recommended for any circumstances. So all this work has been done, but it's more about surveillance. Then number seven, the implementation of the fourth so-called industrial revolution. And that's another topic on its own, which you won't get into now, was the deployment of 5G. And where it will be implemented, the effects of its implementation and laws pertaining to it. Number eight, that human activity has been brought to a standstill where people have not focused on the real things of life which we should be focusing on. The amount of oppression and zulm that is taking place, wars, threats of wars, sanctions, military violence, occupation, like in Palestine, Tibet, and other areas. The destruction ecologically, whether it's the oceans, the atmosphere, all of that has been sugar-coated by the propaganda. And number nine, the desire of human extinction, climate control, and the collapse of reducing the population on Earth. So part of their focus, and has been discussed before, is reduction of the population for the elites. And that's from the World Trade Organization. These are trusted entities which we cannot trust. The UN, the World Health Organization, International Monetary Fund, World Economic Forum, European Commission, European Medicines Agency, the list goes on and on and on. But the primary focus, and they are controlling, whether it's international institutes, important fields, whether it's health, medical, educational, media, economic, and the list goes on. But these institutes are coherent, and they transnational, or we can say supranational. Why? Because they've got a common goal, and this system is independent of all political system, electoral changes. It is something that is ongoing, it is perpetual. So whether a president changes, a situation changes, a person changes, these institutes remain. And even though they've been through many scandals, there's been no scratch or tarnish on their reputation. So coming to the point what Nabi alayhi salam has highlighted, they are the most treacherous, but they still regarded as trustworthy. And those that are trustworthy are regarded as treacherous. Just look at the data on the COVID and reporting of the deaths, etc. So if we look at the methodology, the current statistics which we find today, if we had to go into the actual way which the virus should have been recorded and the death should have been recorded, and come to an actual realistic conclusion, then whatever the data is should have been, and this is not my words again, but there is research out there, it should have been 90.2% lower than what it currently is now. And let us just go through some figures. From children aged 0 to 14, those that have died, and this is CDC in the US, I'm not going to global statistics. 101 have died from influenza compared to 31 COVID-19. And age 0 to 14, there have been 11,158 reported fatalities of all causes. This is on the July 12th data, so before July 12th. These are of all causes, and COVID was 31, which is 0.0278% of all fatalities. So if we say in schools, and kindergarten should have been closed, we're working on 0.0278%. And I haven't even got into statistics of other causes of deaths, but just influenza means all schools should have been closed forever, because that is three times the amount of COVID. Let's go to age 15 to 24. 41.2% from the age of 15 to 24 have died. That is 267 through pneumonia and 157 to COVID. And remember, when you said COVID-19, we're referring to the current statistics, not minusing 90.2% and shaving that figure off. And that is 1.14% of all fatalities of children, people aged 15 to 24, of 13,721 reported fatalities of all causes. Let's go to the next age group, 25 to 54. So this is of the age which we're saying which is ideal. Let's look what the data statistics are telling us. 9,268 people had died of pneumonia compared to COVID-19, 9,034. And if we look at the total fatalities from all causes, 146,663. In this age group, it makes up 6.16% of all fatalities. Only 6% on not the actual figure. And then from age 55 to 64, 16,469 people with pneumonia compared to 14,963 of COVID. And the total amount of fatalities of all causes, 178,884. So that makes up around 8.21% of all cases, compared to 12% of other cases, if we look into the statistics of pneumonia. So even if we had to go by data and not correct data, there is no justification for any of the steps implemented. And if we look at just the death count and considering a person a patient, so if we look at the CDC provincial death count, number one, include probable fatalities unconfirmed by testing. So when a person has influenza or pneumonia, they go through the process, you know, you've gone to the hospital, there's tests upon tests. Yeah, it's probable fatalities and unconfirmed testing. Then number two, does not have any accompanying data to detail how many of the fatalities had significant underlying pre-existing medical conditions. So even people who, there's a 99.999% chance, la ilaha illallah, that the existing conditions would take a person to his qabr, they will go by the 0.001% chance that it is COVID because of the test, which is speculative. Number three, does not have any accompanying data to determine if any of the fatalities were treated in a hospital setting and if the subsequent fatality was a result of the treatment. So, what were the steps were followed? What medication was administered? Was the procedures in place or not? So that, no evidence. We just term it as this death, put them to the graveyard, and no follow-up, no autopsies, no processes in place. So the chances of contracting influenza, and if we look at just the age group of children and teens, there's a greater chance more children will die of influenza. This is just one cause of the amongst many causes, than even COVID. So we should ask the question, why did the CDC decide to create a unique reporting rule for COVID-19 when from 2003, there were successful reporting rules already stipulated and it existed? So if there was well-established guidelines and reporting of fatalities, why was there now, which just recently was made up, new guidelines? And these guidelines were prepared under the direction of the National Institute of Health, instructed by physicians, medical examiners. They were told that you're going to go by these guidelines on March 24th. One was that the underlying cause of death would be more often than not. They would list it as death part one, means primary cause of death. And it wouldn't be any other of the chronic symptoms which a person had, which would be regarded as part two. It would be allowed for probable cases, hospitalizations and fatalities. There was a way where minimum standards of evidence, means a person had a single cough, COVID. Then it created a way of bypassing laboratory tests, means laboratory tests were insignificant. And a minimum standard was created for more people to have the outbreak. And the methodology was flawed. So a lot of speculation, a lot of question marks. Again, innahum yakiduna kayda wa akidu kayda. Do what Allah tells you, see how Allah's help and protection comes, and if you fail, then don't blame anybody else. The amal for today is to read Alhamdulillah illadhi kasani hadha wa razaqanihi min ghayri hawlin minni wala quwa. We read this when wearing new clothing, then a person's past and future sins will be forgiven. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.